I think that the Fed is being forced by circumstances, by the data itself, to conclude that they've done enough on the restrictive side. If they're lucky, the economy won't take a dive on it and will continue to grow.
On WealthTrack, is the tried and true adage, follow the Fed, becoming impossible to follow?
Funding provided by Clearbridge Investments, First Eagle Investments, Royce Investment Partners, Baird, Matthews Asia, Strategist Asset Management, and Women Investing in Security and Education.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. Don't Fight the Fed is a classic piece of investment advice that has been remarkably helpful to investors over the years. As regular WealthTrack viewers know, it's a phrase coined by Martin Zweig, a legendary technical analyst and investor who predicted the 1987 market crash to the day and was the author of the 1970 investment classic, Winning on Wall Street. Zweig wrote, "The monetary climate, primarily the trend in interest rates and Federal Reserve policy, is the dominant factor in determining the stock market's major direction." On the face of it, it makes sense. When the Fed raises interest rates, making money more expensive, business slows down and stocks become less attractive. Conversely, when the Fed lowers interest rates, borrowing becomes cheaper, business picks up, and stocks become more attractive. If only it were that simple. We seem to be in a world where the economy and businesses haven't yet absorbed the full brunt of the Fed's historically aggressive pace of interest rate hikes over the last year, and the market can't seem to make up its mind. This week's guest has been closely following the Fed during his 40-year investment career. He is Ed Yardeni, head of Yardeni Research, a global investment strategy firm he launched in 2007. He is a PhD economist, strategist, and Fed watcher. He has a comprehensive Fed Center on his website, which is just about everything you want to know about Fed history, policy, statistics, and research. And he's the author of several books, including Fed Watching for Fun and Profit, A Primer for Investors, which we discussed at length with him a couple of years ago in an interview available on WealthTrack.com. He writes, "To do this job well, I've learned that nothing is more important than to anticipate the actions of the Federal Reserve System's Federal Open Market Committee, FOMC, which sets the course for monetary policy in the United States." I asked him what he is anticipating from the Fed now.
The Fed has consistently said that they are data dependent. They do a lot of talking and a lot of speaking as individuals, but once they get together for their meetings to decide on monetary policy, it is very much dependent on what the economic data is showing and what the overall economic environment is. I think they have to conclude that the economy is slowing. They'll probably have a debate on whether it's a soft landing or a hard landing and whether it's still strong enough to allow them to raise interest rates some more. I think they're going to come to the conclusion that it's time for a pause to see how it all plays out. So I don't think they're going to do more than they've done already. And I think the Fed funds rate stays at 5%. I think they're going to try to keep it there for a while, as long as the economy doesn't sink. And I don't expect that it will sink. So I think we could have a situation where the Fed's done, but we're not going to see rates coming down as rapidly as the fixed income markets seem to believe.
The Fed has made it quite clear that it wants to get inflation down to 2%. That's their target. We're a long way from there. So, does that put that goal in jeopardy if, in fact, that they're going to pause interest rates for a while?
I don't think so, because, again, I think they've been trying to find that narrow path that allows them to raise interest rates to bring inflation down without causing a recession. That's been their goal. And if you look at something called the Summary of Economic Projections, the SEP, it comes out every quarter from the FOMC, from the Federal Open Market Committee. And that basically shows what their scenario is in their minds that they're trying to achieve and they think they will achieve over the next few years through 2025. And what that shows is that they're shooting for inflation to get down to 2.5% by 2025, which I think is a very realistic kind of time frame. And they were showing that they wanted to get the Fed funds rate just a little bit above 5%. And, they're basically there. I don't think they have to go any further.
Why do you think that's doable?
Our economic volatility in recent years has been pandemic related. I think there was a big surge in demand for goods, particularly consumer durable goods. You know, my family, like everybody else's, was locked down there at home in March and April of 2020. Didn't give us any opportunity to spend money. So we did see people saving more because they couldn't spend it. And then, of course, the government started to put lots of money into people's checking accounts. So there's this huge demand for consumer goods that caused, that's really was the leading edge of inflation, particularly consumer durable goods. That inflation rate's come down sharply. It's back down to zero, basically. And even non-durables, we're seeing that food and energy prices, maybe food hasn't come down, but it's not going up, and energy prices have come down. Now, because of OPEC Plus decision to cut production, maybe they'll go up some. But I think on balance, goods inflation is moderating substantially. It's the services side, but the services side tends to be a laggard, particularly in rents. And we know that current market rent inflation has come down rather substantially. So I think it's kind of already baked, you know, it's baked in the economy to see a moderation in inflation.
The Fed's financial condition, Ed, has changed tremendously. For the first time in its history, number one, there was an article in the Wall Street Journal saying that it's actually losing money. It's running an operating loss of $42 billion since September of 2022. It's got long-term investments that it's getting 2% on, and basically it's got to pay on, you know, reserves of 4.6%. So it's got the same kind of problem that other banks do.
Right.
Are you concerned about the financial condition of the Federal Reserve and also its ability to finance all of the projects that it's been doing in the economy?
Right. I think at this point, they made it clear last summer, and they've been following up on the idea that their balance sheet is too big and that they want to see it reduced. So when securities mature, they don't buy new ones. They just let them roll off. And so they have been actually reducing the size of their balance sheet, but they have a long ways to go. But I've observed over the years that I've been doing this that supply and demand for credit don't seem to really drive interest rates. It's more inflation and the perception of what the Fed is going to do about inflation. So indirectly, what happens in the supply and demand for credit obviously has an impact because it can influence inflation. But as we're seeing now, the fixed income markets are anticipating that inflation will be coming down and that the Fed's just about done, if not actually done, tightening. And in that scenario, we've seen a bond rally, and notwithstanding all the concerns that you rightly express about the amount of debt that has to be financed and the role of the Fed in financing that. One of the things that I've observed from a supply-demand perspective is foreigners have actually been huge record buyers of treasury bonds and mortgage-backed securities in the United States. So there's a lot of moving parts when you look at all these issues.
Central banks around the world have also been buying gold. Now, that tells you something too, right?
Well, we've got a geopolitical issue around the world now. I guess there's always something geopolitical to worry about, but you know, you can't help be concerned about the growing Cold War that seems to be heating up between China and the United States. And of course, there's a hot proxy war between the United States and Russia now in the Ukraine.
Let's go back to the fact that for the first time in history, the Fed is losing money. How, number one, what's going on there? Why is that happening? And why isn't that a concern? Or is it a concern for you?
No, it's not a concern for me. You know, the Fed is the central bank. The Fed does print money, in effect. They have to pay their staff, obviously. In the past, they actually ran a surplus because
yes, they did.
They owned government securities and they had net unbalanced that created income that they then went back and gave to the Treasury.
Right.
So in this situation, they're not giving back to the Treasury. They're they're just dealing with the income and outflow that they're experiencing. But there's no limit here that suddenly they're going to run out of money and not be able to pay their bills. And, you know, I mean, they do basically create these these assets. We've all seen that the bank's balance sheet has been falling, as we said, because of the maturing treasuries. But then suddenly the banking crisis breaks out, and they open up a banking liquidity facility. And as a result, their balance sheet total assets have actually gone up, notwithstanding the fact that they're still letting bonds mature. So,
right, and explain that, this new lending facility to banks, where they're accepting the bank's treasury holdings, which have, because interest rates have been rising, the principal has declined. So the collateral that the banks have, they are, the treasuries and the Fed are having to make good on, and they're accepting it as if it were, you know, as if the treasuries hadn't lost any value at all. So isn't that inflationary?
Consuelo, look, I don't like the mess that we're in, that the Fed basically created.
And explain that. Explain why the mess that the Fed created. What's the mess, and how did they create it?
The mess is that the Fed, you know, provided an environment of free money for a very long time.
Right.
They I think overreacted to the 2008 financial crisis and felt that there was that they had to keep interest rates near zero and pumping in liquidity in order to avoid a depression. And as a result of all that free money, which only got freer and more of it as a result of the pandemic, a lot of people just assumed rates were going to stay very low, and a lot of bankers assumed they were going to stay very low. And suddenly the Fed was confronted with a situation where they completely misjudged inflation. It came back with a vengeance, and suddenly they're scrambling to raise interest rates. And the result has been a shock to the banking system. And so that would have actually been deflationary if they hadn't come in and provided this liquidity facility. So
right.
I perfectly agree with you that there's concerns that at some point, if they keep doing this, kind of bailing everybody out with these emergency procedures, isn't that going to be inflationary? It's a tough call, but I think their initial reaction is correct, because I think it could have led to a massive bank run. We all know, as a result of Silicon Valley Bank, that bank runs now can occur in a matter of minutes as
Absolutely.
People use their smartphones. And so it's a whole new world that suddenly the Fed's confronted with. And so they had to jump ahead of that, and I think they succeeded at that. But as we saw in the great financial crisis, a lot of people thought that it was over, and it just kept going and going and going. And I think that's one of the reasons that people are so nervous right now, is because it wasn't too long ago that we all lived through a financial crisis, and it took a while for it to finally end. And it was very painful in the stock market and for a lot of people.
Jamie Dimon, the chairman and CEO of J.P. Morgan Chase, he said that there would be repercussions to the banking crisis, that he felt that it wasn't necessarily over. And so, you know, how concerned are you? How concerned do you think the Fed is?
Well, that was his letter to shareholders.
Shareholders, right.
And he's in a much better position than I am to assess how the economy is doing. He knows, it's the largest bank in America, and he's can assess all the loan demand, and he knows himself what the bank itself is considering in terms of tightening down on lending standards. So I take his statement as very, very important. But at the same time, I think that there was some ambiguity in what he was saying, because it could also imply that he was saying there's going to be a lot of regulation that's going to be put on small and regional banks. And I think that's clearly the case. It's going to happen.
Right. Well, but he also said in that letter, which I would highly recommend that everyone read, is that, you know, regulation would have not averted the problem that Silicon Valley Bank and Signature Bank had, and that in fact, the law of unintended consequences with more regulation could be considerable. So he's definitely not pro more regulation and doesn't think it would have solved this problem to begin with.
Right, but he knows that politically that's what's coming. Look, he's been on the pessimistic side for a while. He was last summer or spring talking about a hurricane is coming, and he was predicting that there would be a recession in the second half of this year. once consumers ran out of their excess savings. So we'll see how that plays out. I don't agree with that. I think real wages, inflation adjusted wages, are actually starting to increase. Disposable income, adjusted for inflation, is starting to increase. And you put it all together, and I think the consumer still has purchasing power, and I think they'll keep the economy growing. And then, as we said before, there's lots of fiscal stimulus in the economy from all the programs passed by the Biden administration, and that's going to be stimulative. Housing, we know single family has already been in a recession. It's probably hitting a bottom now. Multifamily still looks pretty good. But on the other hand, we've got commercial real estate. So a lot of balls in the air right now. And continues to be a debate about soft or hard landing. It was February of this year that the consensus flipped around from the idea of a hard landing. And that was the consensus at the beginning of the year.
You're right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So people thought hard landing. And then by February, they were talking about no landing because the economic data was so strong. And now with the data that we're getting February and March, they're coming in, oh, no, it is slowing down again. And maybe it's a soft landing again, or maybe it's a hard landing. You got to keep your wits about you here. Things are pretty dynamic. But all in all, I've been impressed by the resilience of the economy, and I think it will continue to surprise us.
I don't want to leave the issue of the capacity of the Fed and also the Treasury to constantly intervene to prevent crises from basically from exploding. And one of the things that you mentioned that the Fed and the Treasury have done is, you know, opening this new facility for banks to borrow. But also, we now have this kind of, blanket insurance for all bank deposits. Does the Fed still have the capacity? Does the Treasury have the capacity, given our borrowing needs, to really take on that role as well?
Well, look, the Fed does not have the power to insure deposits. It's the FDIC, which then gets its authorization from Congress. And so deposits are still insured up to a maximum of $250,000. Nothing's changed in that regard. I would say it's a matter of semantics. Instead of the Fed insuring all deposits, it guaranteed the safety and stability of the banks themselves. So it said, okay, you may have more deposits than are insured, but we can guarantee you that we have just now provided all the liquidity that any bank would possibly need. And all they have to do is bring in their collateral, and we'll price their collateral at par. So they're being very liberal, very generous with this liquidity facility. But as I said, they have an experience since 2008 with kind of whack-a-mole. You know, something terrible pops up, and they take a hammer, and they come up with a new liquidity facility to kind of make that problem go away. And we've seen in numerous times where it turned out that the liquidity facility didn't have to be used very much at all, because it's all a matter of confidence. At the end of the day, that's the most important thing we have going for us. And I think to the extent that the Fed has been successful with that facility, then we'll see. It's not over until it's over, right? I mean, this is an ongoing situation. And as I said, I'll be tracking the data on the banks on a weekly basis along with everybody else to see whether deposits are still flowing out. The past couple of weeks that came as a result of the banking crisis, we've seen a spike up in deposits one week, and then it kind of slowed, deposits leaving, and then another week it came down. And we saw borrowing going up a lot, and some of that was at the traditional discount window, and some of that was at this banking facility, which is allows you to borrow for a year. But again, they could, if necessary, they'll come up with more provisions to provide that kind of safety net.
It's all about confidence, Ed.
All about,
yeah. You're right. Perception is 9/10 of reality. I mean, how confident are you in the stability of the U.S. banking system and the global banking system after that?
Well, I think since the 2008 calamity, there has been a lot of regulation and stress testing of the large banks, and I think they're in good shape. I will not be surprised if we see a whole slew of mergers and acquisitions of community banks and regional banks. You know, we've gone down this road before with the savings and loan associations. We had a real crisis in that sector back in the late 80s and early 90s, and that was very similar. It was a disintermediation problem. Interest rates went up in the money markets, and people said, I don't want to keep my money in an S&L. And some S&L said, no, keep it here. We'll give you a great rate. And then they took excessive speculative risk on their loan portfolio, and things blew up. As I said, in 1990, we had a recession that lasted all of 8 months, but the economy stayed sort of in a soft landing scenario for a while, because it was a body blow to have an important part of the credit system have to be rearranged. And I think the same thing could happen here.
I started this interview in my introduction to you by mentioning the fact that the adage, don't fight the Fed, has been a really, you know, good investment principle to follow for many, many years. Does don't fight the Fed still work?
I think so. For most people's investment lives, of depending on when they started all this, but a lot of baby boomers for sure, I think if we're looking at the Fed's impact on investing, it's been critically important to keep on top of what the Fed is doing, what they're thinking, and what they might do. And there was the concept of the Fed put that was invented by Alan Greenspan back in the mid-1980s. And that kind of has been carrying us on for quite some time, where anytime we see the market go down in a big way, the Fed comes in and eases. I mean, we saw that last in the pandemic, where things were just coming totally unglued. And I think it was on March 23rd that they came in and announced all these liquidity facilities, and the market just V-shaped straight up, and the economy had a V-shaped recovery. But now what's changed is, because of the impact of the pandemic and because of the excessive combination of fiscal and monetary policies, we've seen inflation make a big comeback, and now the Fed had to take the put away and actually go the other way and say, we're just going to keep raising interest rates until inflation comes down. But I think creating the bank liquidity facility, in effect, was bringing the Fed put back. They were basically saying, we're not going to let this thing fall apart.
So if from an investment point of view, if I were to follow the adage, don't fight the Fed, what should my investment strategy be?
Well, with benefit of hindsight, certainly last year was don't fight the Fed's intention to raise interest rates and raise them aggressively, because they realized, they were embarrassed that they were kind of slow to understand that inflation was peskier than they had anticipated. I think in the current situation, I look at their response to the bank crisis as classic lender of last resort activity by the Fed. And when the Fed does that, economic outlook and the stock market outlook and the bond market outlook improve. I think that the Fed has moved towards, is being forced by circumstances, by the data itself, to conclude that they've done enough on the restrictive side. If they're lucky, the economy won't take a dive on it, and will continue to grow, and will allow them to keep the Fed funds rate at 5% until they're satisfied that inflation's well on the way to going down to 2.5%.
So the don't fight the Fed strategy would be moderately bullish? That
yeah,
stocks
I think so.
And bonds should do well?
Yep, I think so. I think that's the way I would look at it.
One investment for a long-term diversified portfolio in this environment of pretty, it sounds like a relatively positive investment environment. What would your one investment be?
Well, I like stocks, and I like stocks for the long run. I mean, it all depends on individual investors' time horizon. But I think last time we met, I suggested the S&P 1500, a diversified mix of big cap stocks and middle-sized companies and small companies. I think America's economy is in great shape. I think that technology is going to solve the labor shortage problem. I think productivity is going to make a comeback. I will not be surprised if by the end of the decade, we can look back and say, you know what, as bad as it was at the beginning of the decade, it really turned out to be the roaring 2020s, because technology solved the problem of labor shortages. That in turn boosted purchasing power and kept inflation down.
Thank you, Ed. I certainly hope you are correct in your assessment. So, Ed Yardeni, thanks so much for joining us again on WealthTrack.
Thank you.
At the close of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is, if you want to follow the Fed, read Ed Yardeni's book, Fed Watching for Fun and Profit, A Primer for Investors. As you just gathered, Yardeni knows the history of the Fed, how it works, and how to use its policies to your advantage. He is also a very good and entertaining writer. This book is meant for investors, but you don't have to be a sophisticated one to understand it. Enjoy it and potentially profit from it. Next week on Wealth Track, the author of Sustainable, Terence Keeley, a former top executive at BlackRock, explains why ESG investing doesn't work and what does. In this week's extra feature, Ed Yardeni, a weekly movie and TV reviewer, names his favorite streaming series from the last year. Please follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and our YouTube channel. Thanks for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a healthy, profitable, and productive one.